Let's continue with chapter number 7 from your history book of grade 7. And the name of the chapter is Rise of Vijayanagar and Bahamani Kingdoms. And today we're going to start from the achievements of the Vijayanagar Kingdom. First of all, you're going to understand about the administration. And during that time also, Vijayanagar Kingdom divided its administrative work in the central government, provincial government, and village administration. They also made three different, you can say, levels of the administration. Let's begin. Central government. The king was the head of the administration. Okay, like at present we have the president and the prime minister, right? Same thing here. The king was the head of the administration. He was an absolute ruler. That means he was having the total control. All the powers were in his hand. Nobody to stop him. Okay. He was an absolute ruler and his will was the law. That means whatever he used to wish, whatever was his will, whatever he desired, that used to become the law. He was worshipped by the people as God's representative on earth. A council of ministers chosen by him assisted him in administration. Assisted means helped him. Okay. Next. Provincial government. The empire was divided into six provinces. Rajya or Mandalam. Each province was placed under the charge of a governor, like we have now. State government, right? Same thing we are finding here. Each province was placed under the charge of a governor who was responsible for the administration of that province. The province was divided into districts, Nadu. And each district consisted of a number of villages or grama. Next, we are having village administration. Like we have the panchayat. Similarly, like that. The village was at the bottom rung of the administrative ladder. The old feudal system, that means the old zamindari system, was revived and officers governed the village. The post of these officers was hereditary. That means it was the post of the officers, like now somebody is becoming officer, next his son will again become or take the place of his father. Okay, it's hereditary. Next, economic conditions. Vijayanagar was one of the wealthiest, means rich, they were very rich, okay, wealthiest kingdoms in the 15th and 16th centuries. The development of agriculture and the promotion of trade and commerce, that is business, enriched its treasury. That means they were earning more money from where? The source of income was agriculture and trade, that means business, okay. This, its two main source of revenue were taxes. They also collected taxes like on land and trade. Okay, like property tax and business tax they used to collect. These are the two kind of taxes. The land tax varied from 1/3 to 1/6 of the produce, depending on the quality of the land. So how much the land is producing, according to that, the tax were varying from place to place, which was assisted before the taxes was leveled. Forests were cleaned and more land were brought under cultivation. Tanks, canals and dams were built for irrigation. Once again, what is the meaning of irrigation? Irrigation means artificial way of supplying water to the land where cultivation is taking place. flourishing means developing. Developing trade enriched the kingdom. The markets of Vijayanagar overflowed with foreign imports such as Arabian horses, Chinese silks and Sri Lankan elephants. The main items of export were cotton cloth, sandalwood, rice, sugar and spices. Import means what are the things that came from outside to Vijayanagar market. And export means what are the items that were sold out by the Vijayanagar kingdom to the other, in the other places. Okay, import means to buy, export means to sell. Society. The Vijayanagar rulers revived ancient Vedic customs. Thus, there were no major social or cultural changes during this reign. The society was conservative and governed by religious norms. The caste system was rigid. The Brahmins were powerful and were held in high esteem. That means high position. Women in general were respected, but they did not enjoy much freedom. Child marriage and sati were common practices. A few upper class women, however, occupied high positions in society and participated in social, literary, and even in political life. Religious tolerance. The Vijayanagar kingdoms was staunch, or you can say was totally involved in Hindus. Okay. But they were tolerant and liberal in their outlook. They employed Muslims in the army and administration. There was no discrimination between the Christians, Jews, Muslims and Hindus. Capital city. The magnificent capital city of Vijayanagar was developed around Hampi, a village which was considered a holy place. The city was surrounded by 7 concentric walls and its total circumference was 96 kilometers. The streets were paved and well laid out. The city was adorned to, or you can say the city was, around the city there were many, or in the city also there were many gardens, lakes, okay, temples. Fresh, sweet scented roses were sold in abundant. Everyone wore jewelry, diamond, rubies, pearls, emeralds were sold openly in the crowded bazaar. So you can understand it was a very, we can say that Vijayanagar was a very rich kind of a kingdom where diamonds are getting sold in crowded bazaar, right? And not only that, they're having paved streets, right? They're having great walls to protect themselves. They're having somehow, we can say that the streets were not muddy. They're paved with stones. Okay, that means they were well developed. They're well developed, well organized, and they were having a great luxurious life also. From here we can understand. The Vijayanagar kingdom was renowned for its fine cities. Okay, magnificent palaces, very big palaces were there. It was a fine city and it was a very well arranged and beautifully organized. The ruins of Vijayanagar at Hampi reflect the glory of, you can say, the city. Okay, like Viruksha temple, or you can say Hazaram Rama temple. All these are the finest architecture we can find. They're having beautiful architecture. You can see in the picture also. Beautiful architecture was already developed at that time. Minor kind of figures, minor designs, very small designs were done all over the building. It was well organized. Painting, Sculpture, music, dance also made great progress during this time. Okay. Not only that, the growth of Telugu, Malayalam, Tamil, Kannada received a great boost during this time. Travelers also came here. Portugal travelers, Persian travelers, they came to Vijayanagar kingdom and they started documenting or they started writing about whatever they saw about the kingdom. This is also one source from where we come to know about Vijayanagar kingdom nowadays. But if you try to calculate the evil part, at that time the society already have developed according to the later Vedic period. The caste system was becoming rigid, Brahmins were becoming more powerful, and women were not enjoying so much of freedom. Child marriage, sati, all these were coming into practices. Other than this part, we can say overall, people were developing. People were enjoying their lives in Vijayanagar kingdom.